15, our Lord tells us, shares three parables that are very familiar. It's one of my favorite passages in all of the Gospels, Luke chapter 15. He talks about the parable of the lost sheep and the parable of the lost coin. It's a picture of God's love and how he'll go to no ends to find the one that's lost. And he ends with my favorite, the parable of the lost son, but it's also called the prodigal son. And of course, this is a story of the younger son in the bunch who was basically ungrateful and disrespectful and entitled, and said basically, "I want my money and I want it now, and I'm hitting the door." And his father gave him his money, and he left. And the Bible says, I just want to share this before because it ties in with the song. Verse 13, it says, "Not long after that, the younger son got together all that he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth on wild living. And after he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. Keep in mind, the father that he left behind was wealthy. When he came to his senses," and I love that part, he says, "when he came to his senses," this was the turning point. You know, sometimes people have to learn the hard way and come to the end of themselves before they come to their senses, and that's what we see in this story. He came to his senses. He said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare, and here I am starving to death? I will set out, and I will go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' So he got up, and he went to his father." And I love this next part. You see, because this story is, you know, oftentimes the prodigal son gets all the spotlight, but really I think the ultimate main character in this story is the father. "But while he was still a long way off," the son, "his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. And he ran to his son." This is the first time that I can remember or recall in Scripture where it describes God, as it were, as a father who runs. "He was filled with compassion. He ran to his son. He threw his arms around him and kissed him." You know, that father could have said, first of all, he could have just stood off in the distance and waited for him to come to him. He could have said, "How dare you come back? What insolence, what arrogance, and now you've wasted all the inheritance that I've given you." I mean, he really could have rubbed it in, right? But that's not the picture that we see in Scripture of our Father's love. He was filled with compassion. He ran to his son. He threw his arms around him and kissed him. And the son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to his servants, "Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." Hallelujah. And so they began to celebrate. This is the picture of our God's love. Jesus said in the first part of this passage, he said, "So I tell you, in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent." This is how much God loves the sinner and the backslider. You know, but some people feel like they are beyond. They've gone too far. Outside of God's grace, beyond his reach. But I'm here to tell you today, on the authority of his word, you can never go too far. His hand is extended. His grace is greater than our sin. And he's calling you, if you're a son or a daughter, a wayward son or daughter, or maybe you have someone in your family who needs the Lord in that way, I just want to give you encouragement today that the Lord is seeking and he's waiting for them to come. Just keep praying, keep hoping and believing, because we serve an awesome God who loves us with an everlasting love. Would you give the Lord praise today? So I want to share this song about the prodigal son from, and the father's love from the son's perspective. Almighty God, the great I am, immovable rock, omnipotent, powerful, awesome Lord, victorious warrior, commanding King of Kings, mighty conqueror, and the only time, the only time I ever saw him run was when he ran to me. He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, "My son's come home again." Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes. With forgiveness in his voice, he's his son. Do you know I still love you? He called me by surprise when God ran. The day I left home, I knew I'd broken his heart. And I wondered then if things could ever be the same. Then one night I remembered his love for me. And down that dusty road ahead I could see. It was the only time. It was the only time I ever saw him run. And then he ran to me. He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, "My son's come home again." Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes. With forgiveness in his voice, he's his son. Do you know I still love? He called me by surprise, and he brought me to my knees when God ran. I was so ashamed, all alone, and so far away. Oh, but now I know that he's been forgiveness in his voice. I felt his love for me again. He ran to me. He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, sent my sons come home again. Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes. With forgiveness in his voice, he said, "Son, I call you son."
Thank you, Pastor Chad.
And in your copy of God's Word, would you turn to Joel chapter 2, verse 25. Joel chapter 2. If you don't know what Joel is, look for Matthew. That's an easy one. And go left. Joel chapter 2, verse 35. While you're turning, I want to say a couple of things. First of all, my wife and I were so delighted that today we celebrate, like Brother Ken said, 18 years serving the Lord here at Family Life Assembly of God. And I'm here to tell you that my wife and I still have the same passion, the same vision, still see in the Spirit what God has ahead. Praise the Lord. I'm not running out of gas. The Lord has given us new gas. Amen. Praise the Lord. We're excited knowing what God is doing here. I also, a couple things. I'm just being a pastor. I want to recognize, see, Pastor Brock and Carolyn, your son Beck is home from college. Or are you? I was wondering why Sister Carolyn is bouncing off the walls. Her son, one of our pastor's son, home from college. And then I see Brother Kwame home. Where are you now? Angola, Kuwait, what country? Kuwait. You're home to visit your family, members of our church. Amen. And we love to see our church family. Let me say one more thing before I read. The Bible tells us to honor and pray for our leaders. So that means you pray for your leadership, not just church, leadership in the White House. I got three amens. Okay, I get it. Leadership in Congress, leadership in state government. We're called to pray. I know a lot of these guys and women, they're godless, but we're called to pray. And the Bible says to honor those in leadership. I'm not getting amens on that one, but we're called to honor and pray. However, we are called, and I know I'm called as a pastor, to address when one of our leaders makes an influential statement, because when you are in leadership, whatever you say hits the news and everyone reads it. It is influential. And whenever anyone makes a comment that I think is so influential and is twisting the truth of God and is trying to condition our society and the church opinion, I will address it prophetically. This past week, our vice president made a comment. And our vice president said, Americans don't need to abandon their faith to support abortion. It's literally that basic. And when I read my Bible, I see how the enemy used politics to divide the Word of God, the truth from God, from politics, when Pharaoh used politics to have all the midwives kill all the babies to get rid of Moses. Use politics. How Herod used politics to have all the babies killed in Bethlehem because of Jesus. And I'm here to tell you that we uphold the truth of the Word of God. It's not a matter of political opinion. It's a matter of the Word of God. So I'm making a statement that that is untrue. That is contrary to the Word of God. And we're called to be salt of the earth. We're called to influence every sphere of our lives. And we're getting ready for midterm elections. Many of you are citizens of the United States. Many of you are not. You're here working. But for those of you that are citizens of the United States and you have the privilege of voting, I'm letting you know as pastor to vote as citizens of the kingdom of God first. When you vote, you're not an American. You're a kingdom of God person. Do you understand that? You vote according to the kingdom of God. You don't vote according to your race. Black, Hispanic, other, you don't do that. You do vote according to a race, the race of the people of God. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
So I want you to, and you vote with righteousness and your Bible open. The Word of God, this book, informs our principles, informs our faith, informs our convictions, and informs our vote. So I'm letting you as pastor. Oh, pastor, politics? No, this is not politics. This has to do with us being called to be salt of the earth and not letting the tail wag the dog. We're called to be influenced. So I'm here to remind you, when I saw that this week, I said, you know, so many people are going to grab that, and it's a person in high authority, and people are going to think, well, maybe, just maybe, you know, maybe there's some truth behind that. And as a pastor, sometimes I have to prophetically call a spade, and that is not God. We're not supposed to divide that. Amen. Praise the Lord. So you got quiet, and that's okay. I was here to make a prophetic statement and not to get votes. Praise the Lord. Joel chapter 2, verse 25, you have it, say amen.
Amen.
I will repay for the years the locusts have eaten. The great locust and the young locust, the other locust and the locust swarm, my great army that I send among you. I'm going to ask back there if you could find that same verse in the New King James Version. I'm not sure if you have that, but I'm preaching from the New King James Version. Amen. So I'm going to read it again from the New King James Version. I like that, but I want to read it from the New King James Version. And the other scriptures, Pastor Chad, that need to be New King James Version. Thank you. There's many translations, but I want to make sure that we're on the same page. Let me read it again. So I will restore to you the years that the swarming locust has eaten, the crawling locust, the consuming locust, and the chewing locust. This morning, for the next few moments, I'm going to preach on the subject, after the locust. After the locust. You pray for me and I pray for you. Father, right now we pray for the moving of the Spirit for the next few moments, Father, as I preach the Word of God that you have instilled in me. Lord, I pray that our ears and our heart will be open to the Word of God. Lord, we've been listening to a lot of words this week on the media, on YouTube, on television, on the internet, a lot of words. Everyone's speaking the Word. But Father, I pray right now that your Word will bypass all these other words, cancel any other word that is contrary to your Word. And I pray that your Word will come alive. I pray for the anointing as we preach the Word of God this morning, that truth will rise. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated if you're able to. Pastor Cortez, why does stuff happen? Crazy stuff. Why is it happening? I mean, I'm confused. You know, this past few years, it's been crazy, Pastor Cortez. COVID, pandemic. And then we have this crazy crime that is occurring across the United States, brazen shoplifting. Right here in Katy, HEB, someone went there and walked out with $780 worth of food. Brazen, broad daylight. I don't know about you, but this is just that. People are robbing stores in broad daylight, walking in and then walking out like nothing. What is that all about? And then road rage happened here in Katy in the news. I'm not here to spook you. Please don't move away from Katy. But the devil lives in Katy too. a road rage incident with a shooting on 99 and I-10. And then there's the crazy stage of the world, Putin, saying, I'm going to push the nuclear bomb and playing those games. And then we had the other day Hurricane Ian, this hurricane that came and devastated Florida. And then don't forget monkeypox. What is that all about? There are two root causes for this devastation and destruction and disaster in our lives. Two root causes. One, sin in the world. Two, sin of man. All this crazy stuff and more that I told you about is caused by either sin in the world or the sin of man. What do you mean by the sin of the world? We live in a broken world. Basically, what's happening is we're putting band-aids in this world, but we live in a broken world. Until you go to heaven, stuff is going to happen in your life on earth. The Bible tells us that it rains on the just and the unjust. When the storm Harvey came, it hit everybody. Born again Christians, speaking in tongues Christians, and heathens. Everybody got wet. And praise God that one day God's going to create a new heaven and a new earth. But meanwhile, we live in a broken world. And the other cause of this crazy stuff in this world is the sin of man. You see, it is our sinful nature to do our own thing. We resist God, we compromise God, we rebel against God because we are sinful people. We are wired to sin. That's why we're saved and still being saved. As long as we live on earth in this sinful body, we're going to be wanting our default. When you're not surrendered to the Holy Spirit, your default, my default, is to sin against God. And too often people sin. Often people sin. And the thing is, sometimes when people sin, and I'm talking now people that know better, people that have experienced God, people that gave their life to the Lord, and yet they're still sinning. Here's the crazy deal. Sometimes they sin and they get away. They get away with it. They'll sin, lightning didn't strike them, they come to church. They worship, they leave, lightning didn't strike them again. They think it's okay. I haven't dropped dead. Let me do this again. Oh, I'll sing. I'll lead worship. I'll serve in Impact Girls. I'll serve in Royal Rangers because if I serve in church and still sin in the side, the good cancels the bad, and we create this dysfunction way of thinking. But sooner or later, the consequence of sin catches up. Sooner or later, I ain't going to get a lot of amens this morning, but I'm telling you, sooner or later, the party comes to an end. Sooner or later, that dabbling in drugs, that dabbling in alcohol will add mileage. Sooner or later, that promiscuous lifestyle becomes deadly. Sooner or later, that double life destroys the marriage and families. You see, folks, the Bible tells us that your sin will find you. Your sin will come to you and knock on the door and find you. Your sin will find you, show up when you least expect it. You're driving a stolen car, you're driving a vehicle that you haven't paid on, you stop paying your note, and it's been 2-3 years, and you're thinking, you know, this expensive truck I got, it's mine. No one has done anything. Maybe God has allowed me to be blessed with this stolen truck. Sooner or later, someone will show up with a tow truck and with a fine and with an arrest warrant and take it away. Hallelujah. How many of you? I'm not going to ask you. I don't want to know. I don't want to know. I don't want to know who you are. Sin will take you farther than you want to go, keep you longer than you want to stay, and cost you more than you want to pay. Pastor, you're preaching. I mean, that's not how you build a church. You know, preach about sin. Listen, we're called to preach the entire counsel of God. I realize you could preach sermons, never mention sin, talk about the blessing, and people run and grab it. I get it. But that's not what my Bible tells me to do. That's not what I see in the New Testament. You cannot appreciate grace until you understand sin. You cannot appreciate deliverance and salvation until you realize that you're lost. That's why sometimes if you have a good doctor, and you're self-medicating, you're doing your own Google search, and you're telling the doctor how you ought to treat your symptoms, and that, you know, a good doctor, they'll give you rope. They'll let you do your own thing until you crash. And then you're calling from 911, and then you're calling from the ER, doctor, you are right. And then he'll come. Sometimes a good doctor will wait, will give you a rope, will allow you to do your own thing until you crash. I ain't getting any help this morning. I know that. Praise the Lord. After this, I'm going to eat out, enjoy myself, and pat myself on the back, but that's fine. In this passage, we find the kingdom of Judah, the beloved children of God, that had rebelled and sinned against God. They knew better, still chose to do their own thing. As a result of rebellion and sinning against God, they experienced the consequence of sin. This consequence of sin arrived in the form of an invasion of an army of locusts. Locusts, ugly grasshoppers. Swarms of locusts, waves of locusts came and devastated their land. They experienced unimaginable devastation and disaster. Everything green was stripped clean in a matter of hours. We live in a beautiful part of Texas. Here in Cinco Ranch, Folger, all these places. Imagine in a matter of 5 hours, 6 hours, 7 hours, everything green is brown. Everything green is gone. You can't call Mr. Landscape, Brother Enoch. We can't call you. Can you come? There's a certain landscape he can't do. Everything green was stripped clean. Gardens stripped clean. Pastures that fed animals stripped clean. The stored grain and seed for the future was devoured. Even the bark on the trees was stripped off by this devastation of locusts. This swarm and waves of locusts ate away their prosperity, ate away their sense of security, ate away their future, ate away their peace and joy, destroyed their lives, the consequence of their sin. And God allowed it. Why did God allow it? Because he wanted to get their attention. This is something we have to understand. In the Bible, there are many times that God has allowed and used natural disasters to get the attention of people. He's used floods, droughts, famines, plagues, storms, and even big fish. Pastor Cortez, are you like into global warming? Do you believe in global warming? Almost. I believe in global warnings. Do you hear the difference? Not global warming, but global warnings. I believe that many times God allows certain warnings, globally to get the, hey, during COVID, that got the attention of a lot of people for 6 months. Isn't it amazing? We were panicking, what are we gonna do? Biden can help, Trump can help, Fauci can help. It's spreading across the world. We're home. And then things are tapered back. Things are, and people say, okay, I was spooked for a while, but I'm gonna continue doing my own thing. Romans 8:22 says, the whole creation groans and labors with the birth pangs. These things that happen in the world, it's the world groaning. It's the hurricanes and these things happening, crazy things. It's, perhaps could it be God trying to get the attention of his people? God, not just the attention. You know, I believe God is trying to get the attention, not of unsaved people particularly. I believe God is trying to get the attention of his church. He's trying to get the attention of his church that has gotten mellowed and quiet and settled and comfortable. They just want to be entertained. And God said, no, you're called to be salt of the earth, not sugar. I've called you to be salt of the earth. And sometimes he allows us to get the attention of the church. So now God had the attention of Judah. And Judah was all ears. Joel chapter 2, verse 12 through 14. And he, now that he has the attention, he tells Judah, turn to me. He says, now therefore, says the Lord, turn to me with all your heart. That means repent. With fasting, weeping, and with mourning. So rend your heart and not your garments. You know what that means? God is saying, I don't want a show. I don't want a drama. I don't want you to come and be dramatic and cry and have your mascara run down your face, come to the altar and have people catch you and have you do a performance, win an Emmy, wear a Tony, do the Oscar. When you know that once you go out outside that church building, you're going to continue doing your own thing. He's saying that's not repentance. That's just an act. And many times people come and they come and they cry and it's remorse. You know what remorse is? You're crying because you got caught. Repentance is different. Repentance is, oh my, I've done wrong. I have sinned against God and man, and I'm going to turn around and run the opposite. I'm going to burn that little blue black book. I'm not going to hang out with those people. I'm going to burn this other thing. I'm going to get rid of it. And we think that remorse and repentance is the same thing. No, remorse is it's just crocodile tears. Crocodiles cry? Yeah, they cry. Well, I never noticed. You can't because they're crocodiles. They're all wet. They're always wet. And sometimes I can't tell if this is a crocodile tear person crying in the altar or not. But God can. Sometimes I think God says, save the tissue. Leave the tissue box alone. Save it for somebody else that really needs it. Save the act. And sometimes we have people that perform and come and cry because they have family members and they want to let the family members know, okay, I have a little religion here today. And God says, don't do that. Turn to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and with mourning. So rend your heart and not your garments. Don't do a show. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness. Well, he's an angry God. Look at the stuff I've been through. Look at the circumstances he has allowed. Look at the judgments he has allowed. Be grateful that you're not dead. Be grateful he hasn't given you what you deserve. You haven't really experienced the full wrath of God, the full judgment of God. If you had, you wouldn't be here today. He says, he'll be returned. slow to anger and of great kindness, and he relents from doing harm. And then he said, this is the part, I love this part. Who knows if he, after he forgives you, who knows if he will turn and relent and leave your blessing behind him? Have you caught that? He will not only forgive you, but who knows, he may even give you a blessing. Who knows? He may just not just rescue you, but he may be like the prodigal son that came home. He just wanted to be home, and he wasn't expecting a new robe, a new ring. He wasn't expecting a party. God wants to forgive you, but who knows? He may give you a further blessing. Hallelujah. Then he says, blow the trumpet, Joel chapter 2, verse 15 to the first part of 17. Blow the trumpet in Zion. Now, I grew up singing that. I grew up singing the song in worship. How many of you remember the song? Blow the trumpet in Zion, Zion, la, la, la. And we do the Jewish dance. People that never been to Israel trying to do the Jewish dance. Remember that? Every church in America was Jewish. But the trumpet in Zion, Zion. And they would like celebrate. Blowing a trumpet in the Bible had two purposes. One purpose was an alarm for impending doom. We live in Old Katy. And until a few years ago, Old Katy had an alarm. How many of you remember that? Maybe you lived there. Sister Helen, you would know. You've been in Old Katy before Katy was old. I mean, she's like an original. No, there's a few people that are like indigenous. Most of you, you're not even from Katy. You're transplant. But they're like family. And I remember when we first moved here. Yeah, I woke you up, right? Rebecca, what is that? She said, that's the tornado alarm. Tornado alarm. That's when you run, you hide, whatever. We're going to do that anymore. Now we get the phone thing, you know? But blowing the trumpet was either that kind of alarm. The enemy's coming, you know, bunker, you know, hunker up. The second trumpet sound, which is what this is referring to, see, we always sang it differently. Blow the trumpet in Zion. We're going to do battle. No. The second one is the purpose here. It was a call to repentance. Yeah. It was a call to repent. It was the shofar being blown saying, we need to repent. Everybody needs to repent. Everybody. Men, women, children, animals, everybody. Blow the trumpet in Zion, consecrate the fast, call a sacred assembly, gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children and nursing babes, not baby, hey babe, babes. Gather the children and nursing babes. Let the bridegroom go out from his chamber and the bride from her dressing room. Let the priest, verse 17, first part of 17, look at this. Let the priest who minister to the Lord weep before, between the porch and the altar. Let the preachers, let the pastors, let those in leadership weep before God. What do you mean weep between the porch and the altar? The place between the porch and the altar was the entrance to the Holy of Holies. They were saying, priests from the top down, repent before the Lord. I think God is speaking to pastors and clergy across America, saying you need to repent. Stop trying to be good. Stop trying to work your brand. Stop trying to become famous. Stop preaching to people what they want to hear. You need to repent first before there's revival in the church. I'm preaching to myself. I know that. Every once in a while, God will speak to me and say, what was that all about? What was that all about? You are a leader. You represent me. You're not representing yourself. And God will speak to me and correct me. Why? Because he loves you. He loves the church. He loves his church. Hallelujah. 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 And after God tells them, turn to me and blow the trumpet, then, oh, I got happy when I was studying this. The children, Judah, experience the divine then. The divine then. Joel chapter 2, verse 18 to 20. Then, after judgment and after repentance, then the Lord will be zealous for his land and pity his people. And I'm going to add the word, then the Lord will answer and say to his people, behold, I will then send you grain and new wine and oil. Grain and new wine and oil. Grain, new wine, and oil. Grain speaks of fruit, of prosperity. New wine speaks of the joy. Oil speaks of the anointing. Then I'll take care of you. Then I'll give you the joy that you have lost. Then I'm going to give you the anointing that you no longer have. And then you will be satisfied by them. I will no longer make you a reproach among the nation, but I will then remove far from you the northern army, and I will drive him away into a barren area and desolate land. Let me stop there. I will remove far from you the northern army. What was happening here is that after they were devastated, there was yet another swarm of locusts that was coming to do the final killing. They had lost everything. They were stripped, everything green stripped. But yet there was one more, the last dagger, one more judgment coming that will bury them. And God said, you know, you came this close to being buried, but because you have repented, then I will circumvent and I will step in and I will protect you from that army, the northern army coming from the north, and I will drive him, speaking of that last army of locusts, I will drive him away into a barren and desolate land. His face, speaking again of that army, his face toward the sea, towards the eastern sea, and his back towards the western sea. In other words, I'm going to send my wind. I'm going to send the Holy Spirit, and I'm going to drive that wave of locusts that's coming to kill you, and I'm going to drive it into the sea, into the ocean, into the water. I'm going to do that. Verse 20. I read that. And then it says here that I will just remove the northern army. And then it says here there will be, a stench and a foul odor coming. Because the stench and the foul odor, I think probably in the next verse, but it talks about a stench and a foul odor for the dead locusts that God had blown into the ocean. They were dead, were washed ashore by waves, and their putrefying remains filled the air with terrible stench. This was a reminder. When they smelled the impending swarm of locusts that God had blown to the ocean, and they were now dead and stinking, it was a reminder that deliverance, they were delivered from something worse. Sometimes God will deliver you and there'll be a stench to remind you this could have been you. This odor of death could have been you. You came this close to being destroyed, but you repented and mercy stepped in and rescued you from what you This, see, some of you, you were addicted to alcohol, and God delivered you. And maybe you went back one time, and you said, you know what? I'll just have a little Bud Light. The football game is on. And you took a sip, and it tasted like junk. And you're like, I used to drink this by the gallon. What is it? God reminding you that he delivered you from junk. God removes that taste. Some of you had habits that you couldn't live without, and God has delivered you. And for whatever crazy reason, you went back and you tried, and it just wasn't the same. It stunk, and it smelled, and it tasted ugly. That's called grace. That's called grace. Some of the thrill that you had when you were not serving the Lord, now you went back and you took a look and you, oh, I can't believe, that's called, it stinks. That's grace reminding you what you've been delivered from. Musicians, would you come? It was in that setting, and I'm closing, that the Lord said, Joel chapter 2, verse 25, you could throw that on the screen again, Joel chapter 2, the opening verse. And it came, and it shall come to pass, and it shall come to pass afterward, after the repentance, after the deliverance. We don't have it there, but just follow me. And it came to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit. No, that's not it. So I will restore to you the years that the swarming locust has eaten. And then it describes three types of locusts. The crawling locust, the consuming locust, and the chewing locust. I will restore what the crawling locust has eaten. What's the crawling locust? Well, I did some research. And many scholars think that that's describing something called canker worms. Canker worms are inch worms. They chew small holes on leaves. They cause defoliation of the trees. They leave behind larva eggs. So when you think it's over, those eggs hatch and it starts again. You clean it, and then you think it's new leaves start growing again, and then they die again because of the eggs they leave behind. They cause a subtle and slow incremental destruction and death. It's a slow, sneaky destruction. It is a slow, sneaky death. You see, the crawling locust or the cankerworm speaks of a slow addictions. Speaks of, you know, I've worked with many drug addicts, especially in New York City. And all the drug addicts started with one reefer, one drug. Not everyone that takes one reefer becomes a drug addict. But everybody, all the drug addicts that I've met started with one reefer, one marijuana, one pill. And they'll tell you, I never imagined. I just did one. I just took one sniff, one time. And then a month later, I took another one. None of them planned to become addicted. It just came slowly, like an inchworm, like a crawling worm. It was a subtle, slow addiction to alcoholism. It was just a wine. It was just a light beer. It was just one R-rated movie, then another R-rated movie, and why not X movie? And next thing you know, they're addicted to the internet, addicted to pornography. Addicted, like they cannot leave the house until they've done some time on the internet. Addiction, a life-controlling addiction. It all starts with crawling worms. And when those crawling worms, when they come into our lives, they begin to slowly take over, and it affects the appearance of people. Have you ever met somebody and you say, oh, how old are they? You know, to Rebecca, well, I think they're like pushing 70, you know. No offense if you're 70, okay? And then someone says, no, they're 25 years old. What? Because they've been addicted for 10 years. And when you're addicted to any type of substance, it begins to wear your very appearance. It wears your face. Your teeth rot. Your gait, your movement. And it started slowly. That's the effect of the crawling worm. And the Bible says, God says, I will restore the years that the crawling worm has destroyed. I will restore the beauty that you lost. God can restore your beauty or your handsomeness. Only God can do that. And then he says, I will restore the consuming locust. That's talking about the caterpillar. Many scholars think it's talking about caterpillar, not just anyone. The caterpillar is among the most serious agricultural pests because it devours fruit and the harvest. In other words, it speaks of the loss of livelihood, of your bank account, your linked reputation. Everything you work hard for, the caterpillar will destroy it, eat it up. It also refers to the loss of the joy. Loss of the joy. But the Bible says, I will restore what the consuming caterpillar has destroyed. I will restore your joy. I will restore what the enemy has stolen. I will restore it. Ask Job in the Bible. God restored everything he lost and more. Finally, would you stand? The last one. I will restore the chewing locust. That's talking about the palmer worm. These are little hairy black and white caterpillars. Some of you are going to be scratching. I know that. Little hairy black white caterpillars that suddenly appear in great numbers. They show up like a large dark cloud. They speak of a living hell that takes over a life. They blind your life. They engulf a person with a deadly depression. In other words, I believe this is talking about mental health. I believe this is talking about chewing locusts that chew your mental health. It comes like a bit, not just the blues, not just having a bad day, but a major depression. Now I'm going to share something and speak prophetically. Because I believe the Lord has given me an anointing when it comes to praying for people that are dealing with depression. Many times, there's all kinds of depression, blues. I know there's a chemical imbalance. I understand mental illness. My brother in New York City is an ordained minister. He's a psychiatric social worker also. I understand it very well. And sometimes people, you know, your brain is an organ. And so it's just like your heart's an organ, your kidney's an organ, and sometimes you need assistance because it's a chemical imbalance. I understand this. I'm not knocking that. But I believe that there's certain times there's people that are rebelling against God. They know better. And they allow these types of locusts to come. And they come, these caterpillars come in droves. And they start living in this cloud of caterpillars just eating their mind. Eating their mind because of decisions they made. And it makes bad decisions to worse decisions to worse decisions and just get worse and worse and worse. God said, even you, I will deliver you. Let me share a story, and I haven't shared this too often. My brother and I, we had a mother that dealt with a lot of depression and mental issues. That's why I'm so cognizant. I understand mental illness. But then, the 4 or 5 years before I quit the ministry, something was weird with my mother. Extreme. And I couldn't pin it. I couldn't figure it out. She had gotten away from God more, making decisions. It was just, I could feel it. Something was wrong. Both my brother and I. My mother, when my brother and I were growing up, she adopted a little girl. And my mother was very much of an enabler. And this little girl, a stepsister of mine, I was much older, from 14 to 18 was crazy. And my mother was always protecting her. It was just the craziest relationship they had. I was an ordained minister, I was preaching, an associate pastor, my brother's a minister, and we were, what is happening? We don't recognize you. It got worse and worse. At 18, this young lady decided to leave home, hanging out with the wrong crowd, left home, involving drugs. We would get phone calls from the police. Do you know such and such? Yeah, we do. Well, she's on top of a fifth floor tenement building in the South Bronx, high on crack. She's about to jump. And there's 150 people downstairs saying, jump, jump, jump. We just grabbed her. What do you want? Take her to the psych unit. I'm being honest with you. I'm thinking, what is happening? I'm Pastor Albert. My brother's Pastor Jeffrey Cortez. We were raised in a godly home. God delivered us from this junk. Then my mother started having crazy episodes, and she lost it. She went psychotic. I have learned about medication, Pamelar, Trilofan. I know all the meds. Took a psychiatrist in Manhattan. Just psychotic episodes. I mean, just... And my brother and I, what in the world? This is not just depression. This is crazy. It's like caterpillars had eaten. I mean, every time I was around her, I was depressed. It was demonic. A couple years after that, we found out something. My brother said, I just found out something. Aunt Blanca, my mother's sister, finally confided with me. My mother was just, I moved in with her. You know, when you deal with someone who's not right with God and you try to deal with them as a pastor, and what they do, if you deal with them, if they don't like what you're saying, they'll find another enabler. And then that person tries to deal with that person, and when they don't want to be held, they want to do it their way. So my mother went from home to home, and she went to find her sister, an enabler, and after 3 months, she couldn't enable, and she said, I need to tell you something that I've kept a secret from you guys. She said, your mother and her daughter, my adopted sister, when they were 14, the 14-year-old had, she got pregnant. I never knew this. And I helped your mother take the little girl and get an abortion. And your mother kept this a secret for years. I had no idea. And when my brother and I heard this, we were stunned, because she kept this a secret for years. That explains 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. That explains my mother, because she had allowed this judgment, this caterpillars, to eat her alive. It affected my ministry. That's one of the reasons I quit the ministry, because I was just overwhelmed. It affected my brother. I'm being transparent. I'm not sharing this to make points. If I could help one person here. And my mother was never the same. Never the same. Towards the end, she got back to the Lord, but never the same. We lost touch with that girl. All because of a sin. When I said earlier, sin will find you, it'll find you. She kept it low. She went to church. They both went to church, but living a lie.
and it ate them alive, and it started affecting everybody else. Her mental illness got worse because of sin. Can please, I'm not saying everyone who's depressed here, you sin. I'm not, please, you understand what I'm trying to say. But there's certain things that is caused because of unrepentant sin. Hidden sin. Ministers who are sinning and still leading worship and still preaching and still, and then little by little, they get involved in promiscuous lifestyle. No one knows. And then little by little, the family enables them. Little by little, they start getting involved in addictive sexual activity. And no one knows. They're shaking fake, come back on the platform. Until finally, it gets worse and worse. And the wife suspects something, but no one wants to say something. And she's following him at nighttime. And then they see the checking account draining and the retirement funds draining because he's tapping into it. But now he's addicted for that promiscuous lifestyle. And everyone knows, but no one's willing to say anything because to repent is to let it out, and we want to cover. We want to keep things in cover. And then when it explodes, it's like, where did that happen? It didn't happen overnight. It was slow and affected so many people. I hate the devil. I hate the devil. Every head bowed, every eye closed. This morning, you're saying, Pastor Cortez, I want prayer. I want deliverance. I want deliverance. I need deliverance. But first, before this deliverance, I need to repent of my sin. I'm not here to embarrass anybody. But you say, I need to repent. Not crocodile tears, not remorse. I need to repent. There's things that are happening in my life, and I realize until I get it together with God, I'm not right with God. Just because I feel the warm fuzzies in church doesn't mean I'm right with God. It just means grace. But I need to repent. I need to rend not my garments from my heart. I need to repent. I need to cry before the altar of my sin. Only after I repent can God deliver me. I want deliverance, but I need to repent. I don't want to skip over the altar. If that's you, I'm not going to ask you to come to the front, but if that's you, every head bowed, every eye closed, I want to pray for you. If that's you, you need to repent. I'm not going to ask you for details, but you say, I need to repent. God knows what I need to repent from. If that's you, can you lift up a hand real quick and put it back down? Yes, yes, yes. Anyone? Yes. Anyone else? You put it up and put it back down. Anyone else? I need to repent. The Lord has identified the cause. Yes, you can put your hand down. Yes. Father, right now, we come to you. You are a loving God, a patient God, a gracious God, a merciful God. But Father, because you are a good God, we have played games with you. We have played game with you, and there's things that has occurred in our life, and we think you're punishing us, and you're not really punishing us. You're trying to get our attention. If you were punishing us, we would not be standing here in church. You allow certain things, judgment, to get our attention. Hidden sin, well-protected sin, camouflage sin. But Father, you love us so much that you do not tolerate any type of sin, any type of nonsense, any type of professional acting. You're not impressed. You're only impressed with repentance. So Father, for those that have raised their hands, I pray that, well, as they repent of their sins and on purpose choose to burn and get rid of anything that has caused them to live a lifestyle that is unholy, go home, Lord, if they have to disconnect, befriend somebody from Facebook, throw out a CD, magazine, whatever it is, they know, Lord, the Holy Spirit will show them what they need to do to eliminate, to burn it, to cut it away, because they want to live a life pleasing unto you. And Lord, I pray that you would bless them. Heal them, restore them, and bless them. And who knows, you may even give them an extra blessing beyond their ability to comprehend. Who knows?
you will give them the ability to give unto you and help somebody else in the ministry. Father, we thank you for the Holy Spirit that helps us. We don't have to do this alone. We thank you for the Holy Spirit that helps us, enables us. I can do all things through Christ. Through Christ, that's the key, because I can't do all things. But through Christ, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. How does he does that? Through the Holy Spirit. So we allow the Holy Spirit. The purpose of the Holy Spirit is to make us holy, not happy. Holy Spirit, make us holy. Sanctify us as we repent from our sins. Cleanse us. We thank you for your Holy Spirit that not only cleanses us, but helps us grow forward. Helps us walk in victory. Helps us transform scars into beauty marks. This morning, the Lord is telling somebody, I will restore the years that the locust has devoured. The years that the locust has stolen, I will restore. If you turn to me, if you repent to me, if you cry out to me, I love you. I love you so much that I'm speaking straight to you this morning. Come back home. Father, we thank you for the move of the Spirit this morning. We thank you for the Holy Spirit. We thank you for what you're doing in our midst here today. I pray a blessing everybody in this sanctuary, everybody in our Spanish language church, Casa de Vida, every child and children's church in the nursery, in Jesus' name. And everyone together, and everyone said, amen and amen. God bless you. Love one another. We'll see you in church Sunday, Wednesday at 7 o'clock. God bless you.
Who have I to ask beside? How could I doubt his tender mercy?